You've probably been sitting in traffic before, wondering, why is it like this? If only they could add another lane, then this would start moving faster. And while that might seem like the answer, it actually goes way deeper than what you might think. Road design is just one piece of why traffic exists. There are tons of other factors we'll look at to understand the full extent of why you're sitting in traffic. And by the end of this video, you'll never think about traffic the same way again. But first, we need to figure out what traffic is in the first place. By definition, traffic is vehicles moving on a road or public highway. So technically, this is traffic, and this is traffic, but most people would refer to this as traffic. When vehicle speeds begin to reduce as a result of there being more vehicles than the road can handle, causing overall trip time to increase from what might otherwise be less if vehicles were moving at the road's design speed. This is that frustration you feel when you're going 10 miles per hour on a highway, or when you just watch the light in front of you go through a whole cycle and you didn't even get through the intersection. Yeah, that one hurts. So it might be easy to say, this traffic is a problem. But arguably, traffic is never the problem. Traffic is a symptom of many other problems. When we look at the problems people face with traffic, they're all connected in an elaborate system of variables. And the setup of which variables we choose to prioritize can change how an entire society functions. First, let's look at the biggest problem people face with traffic. Time. Most often, time is the real problem people are talking about when they talk about traffic. Specifically, an amount of time that's higher than what would be considered a normal amount of time. If you know you can drive to work in 30 minutes, and today it took an hour because of other cars slowing you down, you'd probably say the traffic was horrible. People hate wasting time, and in the US, this is almost a top priority, if not the top priority when it comes to transportation projects. How can we get people from place to place in less time? Well, we increase speed. Roads can be designed in different ways to increase speed with things like more lanes, wider lanes, fewer curves, and higher speed limits. But naturally, any increase in speed always causes a decrease in safety if a collision were to occur. This is simply a matter of physics. At higher speeds, stopping distances are increased, and if a crash occurs, a greater difference in speed results in greater impact forces. Vehicles are designed to absorb some of that force, and roads can be designed to minimize the risk of a crash occurring in the first place, but inevitably, this is a correlation dictated by physics. This is especially true for those outside of the protection of a vehicle. But why do we really need high vehicle speeds in the first place? Well, because we want to get between places in less time. We covered the time already, but let's look at the between places part of this. When we look at the US as a whole, we see lots of low density development. Simply put, density is how close together we build things, whether that be shops, restaurants, or homes. And in the US, things are typically built pretty far apart. The further apart we build things, the more distance we have to travel to get between those places. Therefore, the more we increase the distance between things, the more it's going to increase time to get between those things, unless we increase speed, which of course lowers safety. For the most part, a balance like this is pretty well accepted by society in the US. Less time, more speed, less safety, and more distance between things. And as a result, this is how a lot of the US was built and how it continues to grow in a lot of places. But growth isn't tolerated very well with this balance. When communities grow by sprawling outward with houses and businesses far apart, it forces residents to drive for most things. As traffic volumes grow, the roads reach capacity, leading to congestion and slower speeds. Of course, this decrease in speed increases the amount of time to get between places. We could accept this as the cost of building large spread out communities with driving as the only option to get around. But this typically isn't tolerated very well by society because we've prioritized saving time and increasing speed, meaning many of our roads were built to allow us to drive fast. This sets our expectation that we should be able to drive fast, and when it doesn't live up to those expectations, like going 10 miles per hour on a highway designed for 70, we consider this a problem, and we'll try to come up with a solution to speed this up. This usually looks like adding additional lanes to the road. More lanes means more cars can fit on the road, increasing overall capacity of that road. This might seem like the obvious solution, and in some cases, it works. However, this introduces some extra variables. The most obvious one is money. Road construction is expensive, and it's done at the taxpayer expense. If you want roads with more lanes, you'll have to pay for them as a taxpayer. Money is a huge variable, and you might not even realize how much you're spending to get around in ways that you might have not even thought of. We'll look at that in a bit, but there are other variables that come with adding another lane. While that new lane just doubled capacity, it also doubled the amount of noise that can come from that road. And with more cars on the road, air pollution also increases. And finally, that new lane takes up land that could have been used for other things. That might seem like a tiny factor to consider since a road lane is typically only 10 to 12 feet wide, but it can begin to add up incredibly quickly, especially when those additional lanes require modifications to intersections or interchanges. Even a road with 11 lanes can still get backed up because of an intersection. Sometimes this is just a result of bad light timing. You've likely been sitting at a red light when nobody is going in the other direction, and optimizing the timing of a light can help reduce some of that delay. But sometimes it's the result of more traffic than the light can handle. In some situations, replacing traffic lights with roundabouts can help improve efficiency of an intersection, and sometimes eliminating the intersection entirely and separating the traffic vertically so the paths of vehicles don't have to physically cross can reduce delays even more. But these ramps require even more space. This is where the effects of land use become incredibly obvious. This interchange in Texas was built to focus on one variable, decreasing travel time. With the amount of space it takes up, you could fit a whole town full of hundreds of homes, restaurants, and parks. Of course, you can't just get rid of a massive highway interchange and replace it with small city streets. It would cause backups for days, right? Well, it depends. If all of the current traffic going through this interchange was suddenly funneled into this setup, yes, it would cause significant delays. But if people knew they were going to get stuck in traffic for several hours, they wouldn't go that way anymore. People are actually pretty creative when it comes to getting around as quickly as they can. If we know that traffic is terrible on one road, we'll go on a different road if we think it'll save us time. Or if we know traffic gets better later in the day, we'll wait until later to drive. But imagine the road is widened with an additional lane, and now there aren't any delays. This is convenient for you because it's faster than the alternate route, and you don't have to wait until later in the day anymore. However, you weren't the only one who was thinking that. And now other people who were avoiding that road are incentivized to use it, and begin filling up the space that the extra lane provided. And now the road is once again moving slowly. So let's add another lane, and when that one fills up, we'll add more. Eventually, this is how you end up with something like this interchange in Texas, which, despite the size, still experiences slow-moving traffic. Of course, there's always a certain point at which road capacity would meet the travel demands without any delays, though. Adding 100 more lanes here, for example, would likely meet the travel demands, but this wouldn't come without a cost. Traffic delays may never exist on a road like this, but it would be astronomically expensive, dangerous, increase air and noise pollution, and take up a massive amount of land, all for people to drive in their cars. Which is actually one of the most crucial variables of all. After all, cars are the things creating the traffic in the first place. And when we prioritize building larger roads for more cars, any growth to that community is going to be incentivized to build more developments around those new larger roads, creating even more demand than what existed in the first place. There are a variety of ways people can get around, and driving is an inherently inefficient mode of transportation when it comes to how much space it takes up. But many people enjoy the individual experience of driving exactly where they need to go within the privacy of their own vehicle. And as a result, we've prioritized cars when it comes to transportation in the US. While ideally we could prioritize everything, the laws of physics and economics mean compromises have to be made somewhere. And in the US, this is usually what that looks like. But we can change what we prioritize. Considering the insanely high number of traffic fatalities in the US each year, prioritizing safety would be a good place to start making some changes. When it comes to safety, there are many factors to consider, but we're just going to focus on speed right now since it's such a vital aspect of how severe a crash is. So in order to increase safety, we need to decrease speed. I have a whole video on some creative ways to do that'll be linked at the end of this video, but any decrease in speed is going to increase travel time. So we have to ask ourselves, is preventing injuries and saving lives worth taking longer to get to our destinations? This is a question we really need to think about as a society. But there are other variables we can prioritize in order to bring down travel times. One of the most obvious is to reduce the distance you have to travel. Building places closer together is one of the simplest ways to do this, but it isn't the only way. We can also change what we build and where we build it. For example, this could mean building a corner store within your neighborhood. Now, you wouldn't have to drive to a larger store down the road and add to the traffic on that road to get something you could get from the corner store. However, this setup doesn't mean traffic congestion won't exist. It could start to slow down if there are too many cars on the road. But if we prioritize giving people more options to get around, it could reduce the number of cars on the road and help improve traffic congestion without having to build more lanes. If places are close enough and we build safe, comfortable infrastructure for it, some trips would naturally be replaced with being able to walk or bike between them rather than driving. This can directly improve health as well by making exercise a part of daily commutes. Creating better infrastructure for walking and cycling would help reduce car trips to an extent, but not everything is within walking or biking distance, and some people can't walk or bike. Public transportation options like buses and trains allow for moving lots of people in a much smaller footprint than cars, and allows people to get around who might not be able to or want to drive. If done right, public transportation can even provide a faster option than driving. This benefits everyone, whether you use it or not, simply because it's getting cars off the road. If enough people switch their trips to different modes of transportation, it would allow us to scale back the size of the roads. This would further improve safety, decrease air and noise pollution, and free up more land. Now that we've changed our priorities to increase safety, shorten travel distances, and create more travel options, we have a completely different set of priorities than what we started with. And as a result, our system of variables changes to be one that is still time efficient, but also has slower vehicle speeds, one that is safer and not as spread out, one with smaller roads and less noise and air pollution, and one with less land used for roads and more options to get around. Thinking about how all of these variables are related uses many of the same critical thinking and analytical skills we use in topics like math, engineering, and data. And with the sponsor of this video, Brilliant, you can push those skills even further with a fun and effective way to learn new things. On Brilliant, you learn by doing with thousands of interactive lessons in math, data analysis, programming, and AI. You'll sharpen your critical thinking skills through problem solving, not memorizing. Not only will you build real knowledge on specific topics that interest you, but you'll also become a better thinker. This approach filled with hands-on problem solving is proven to be 6 times more effective than just watching lecture videos, and it's something you can easily add to your everyday routine. You can learn with just minutes a day, doing fun lessons whenever you have the time. Brilliant has tons of new courses and data that can train you to see trends and make better informed decisions by using real-world data. You can start learning on Brilliant today for free for a full 30 days by visiting brilliant.org/streetcraft or click on the link in the description. And you'll get 20% off an annual premium subscription. If you want to learn in a fun new way, go check out Brilliant. Looking at this new set of priorities, you might notice there's still one crucial variable missing. Money. Transportation costs money. This is just a reality. Unless we all wanted to get around by walking on dirt trails, we need to spend money. And we can break this down into 3 pieces. The first is the money we spend on building infrastructure. This can vary dramatically depending on what is built. Things like massive interchanges and rail networks are incredibly expensive, but making bike lanes or improving a bus route can be relatively cheap. There's also the cost on individuals, and this aspect is huge. Americans spent $1.8 trillion on transportation in 2022, a lot of that going towards vehicles. One estimate found that the average cost of ownership of a new car in the US is over $12,000 a year when you factor in the cost of car payments, insurance, gas, depreciation, maintenance, licensing, and registration. And there's also the cost of crashes. Many factors go into the total cost of a crash, from the obvious vehicle repair costs, to hospital bills, to lost wages, and the list goes on. In 2019, the cost of crashes in the US was $340 billion. This is more than what was spent on building and maintaining all of the roads and highways the same year. But this first piece, what we spend on building, is arguably the most crucial, as it directly affects the other two. For example, spending money to build a safe, comprehensive bike lane network around a city could allow more people to get around without cars, lowering individual costs. And the safer streets could reduce crashes, lowering those costs too. This could actually result in a net savings, making that money spent a worthwhile investment to society. Taking this to a larger scale could have even bigger savings. A recent bill called the High Speed Rail Act calls for $41 billion annually over 5 years to invest in building a high-speed rail network in the US. This might seem like a lot of money, but when we compare it to how much is spent on transportation, between individual spending, the cost of crashes, and construction and maintenance on all of our roads, this is hardly anything. And it has the potential to significantly reduce the number of trips taken by car, once again lowering individual vehicle costs and reducing crashes. How we decide to build our transportation system is the most vital aspect of changing which variables we want to prioritize, because inevitably, what we build is what we have to use. If we build roads exclusively for driving, people are going to drive. But if we build safe ways to walk or bike, people will consider walking or biking. And if we build fast and efficient trains, people will consider taking trains. But another big part of this is our mindsets. As a society, we're so used to prioritizing certain things, but we need to take an honest look at these priorities and decide if they're truly best for us. And once we decide, we can use our voices to speak up about what priorities we want in our communities, because the entire system isn't going to change immediately. It's going to happen slowly with incremental changes that happen in your own community. And this is happening all over the US. One great example is the street in Cincinnati, Ohio that went through a transformation which you can watch next here. And be sure to subscribe if you found this interesting, as there'll be more videos like this soon.